The scene is set in the Paragon Odyssey 15 Theatre, better known as the Odyssey Theatre, the Venture Elysium. John Stansope is within his secret cellar, going through some of the chores that he must in preparation. He wanders down the lab, stopping in on his guests. He takes the time to check in on the Black Rose killer, Francis Chess, seeing that the captive kindred is exceedingly hungry. He throws in a few blood bags, allowing the kindred to drink. Once sated, John will then make sure that his hands are tied, that his secures are still in place, and that the process of healing his missing appendages has not taken place. If there's any hint of the wounds beginning to heal, or he's trying to make himself whole again, John will correct that with a hacksaw. Once the kindred is sated, no longer on the verge of starving, he will take a simple wooden stake and drive it into the heart of Mr. Chess. He cannot have the kindred alone and with a possible chance of escaping. Not until he's truly figured out what he's going to do with this shovelhead. He closes the door and moves through to his other guest, Devon Creed, still torpid, lying on the floor. John looks him over with his medical knowledge, checking if there's any sign of waking. Not that there would be. Two successes, but still. He's never had a chance to study a torpid kindred before. And it is very much like death. You can see the skin begin to sallow and become more corpse-like as the last remaining vitae within him is being consumed, simply keeping his consciousness alive. John will take his apparatus, fix a needle within his arm, allowing some fresh vitae into the blood, making sure that he does not fall completely into torpor. But it will take a few syringes of his own and extract some precious vitae from the torpid Bruja. What doesn't know wouldn't kill him. And it's always best to have an ace up the sleeve. He takes two vials, or at least two blood points worth, just in case one is spoilt or damaged, or he needs to trade one, perhaps with the Tremere, for some favours later on. Once he believes the Bruja is all settled, he closes the door, hoping that Miss Brothers will pick up the torpid Bruja soon. You never know when he'll wake up, and not exactly the best known for their temperament. And there's much expensive medical equipment down here that John doesn't fancy replacing. For the record, he will roll his willpower. He will spend a willpower point to make sure he has already decided that he will not devour any of his charges. But the beast does like to push him so. Ah, yes. Even with the willpower. Two successes. He's adamant now. People know. The Bruja Primogen can no longer go missing, nor can Francis Chess. It is common knowledge they're under his care. John isn't one to take unnecessary risks. The extracted blood is price enough. He places it within this careful container hidden behind one of the fake walls with his other stolen Vitae's. From Eric Summers, from Poddy, and now from Francis Tress and Devon Creed. Creating quite a collection. Perhaps he'll try and collect them all. It would certainly be a display piece, or perhaps we'll have some use later on. He hovers over his own workstation, looking at the various chemicals and drugs, and he starts to ponder. With the Methuselah awake, is there much need to continue his self-medication? He keeps his head level and his emotions clear, but it certainly robs him of any true delight or any variance of emotion that can be considered living. He doesn't like the idea of being beholden to anything, not even chemicals. So he'll lull his self-control and is perfectly fine, adamant. He no longer needs it. The visions are no longer affecting him, and although the beast is a loud and persistent neighbor in his psyche, he feels his strength of will and mind is strong enough to be able to deal with anything that it throws at him. He stores away the chemicals, the blood, the usual routine that's needed. He takes a few vials of prepared Vitae and puts it within the freezer storage. It might be good as a trading piece. Some kindred and hedonists enjoy that sort of thing. Or perhaps if he has another Malkavian visitor, he needs to be a bit more lucid. With his business in the lab concluded, he heads up towards the main office, used by Thomas Williams, within the secret room where the vault and the laundered money comes, so that he can start his project, his expansion into New Sera. Gathering his notes and files, he heads to a small booth, the place he usually did his work before he actually owned the casino. Sitting himself down and ordering a drink, he begins to work in the pleasant environment, marveling at the wonderful swirling patterns of the ceiling, the great engineering work that Thomas brought forward. It still eludes John how this is possible, but modern technology and architecture is something that he was never akin to, and simply marvels at the beauty of the thing. First, it seems that with his success within the Giovanni Ball, he has several meetings. The most important of which is that of the police. The three officers of different scales that had some interest, or at least seemed to be good ways of starting to head into that direction. And so John will roll for each of them. Manipulation and contacts to see how many pieces of information that he can glean from these gentlemen before his meeting, which will only be 6 dice, DC 7 for contacts, of course. The first is this lieutenant pointed out to him by Ewan Dunson. He was certainly interesting, and John enjoys a challenge. The super cop, as he was called, must have dirty secrets, or at least, maybe not vices, but certainly interests. Ways of bringing up conversation, chance meetings, for John to work his own particular art on him. With two successes, he gleans good pieces of information. He certainly finds out this man has a family, The wife's job is of public record and is something he actually takes a lot of pride in. A family man certainly has weaknesses, depending on how difficult John wants to be with him. Secondly is his unprecedented rise within the ranks. Many say it is because of his unwavering loyalty to the law and to his Boy Scout nature. But John doesn't believe it. No one is ever that pure. He marks down the dates of when he rose to prominence and promises himself to cross-reference it with the news and any other information he finds. The next candidate was someone who was generally left alone in the meetings, a little fish out of water. An older officer who seems to have been relegated to the paperwork stands of things, the DMV, the evidence lockers, kept out of the way. Someone with a past, perhaps. Someone that the police want to throw under the carpet. And we'll attempt to find out more about him, although his lowly status, at least in the eyes of the police force, means nothing. He has access to things that will be exceedingly useful for a kindred, and, a man swept under the carpet often wants more. Oh, beautiful. Two wonderful pieces of information there. It's common, I wouldn't say common knowledge, but it's easy enough to dig up why he was relegated. It seems that he has a bone to settle with a rather prominent member of Parliament. He tried to get him up on tax evasion and, the man used his influence to put pressure on his employer, therefore relegating him down into the basement of the police so he couldn't cause any more trouble. It seems there is something else within this man as well. A piece of information very difficult to acquire, but John's contacts have been able to ferret it out. And it is simply that he, has medical bills. The older gentleman has a condition, a heart condition that unfortunately pushes his health insurance every year. If the man doesn't get his police pension, he can expect a very different quality of life. And finally, the last officer works in homicide. Homicide detective himself is a gruff, salt of the earth kind of man. Certainly very keen on his job, a very keen investigative mind, but no social graces nor manners, nor does he need them. He is particularly crazed for the Black Rose Killer. It was certainly a topic of conversation that John lapped up and smiled inwardly when mentioned. We'll see if this gentleman has sorted past. Oh my word, I am doing very well today. Three pieces of information. Not only have we found out that his promotion was that of an underhand deal, he sold out his previous department in the exchange for the sergeantship. That he also has vices of his own. His ambition is driving, and a terrible secret. He enjoys visiting the red light district a little bit too much, perhaps. And finally, we find that, He has an illegitimate son, a child by one of these whores, which he is keeping just outside the city, perhaps in Portland. But he pays for the child in exchange for silence and solitude. All wonderful areas in which to exploit. They will be coming to the Nobility Hill soon enough, all to meet John on one pretense of another, dominated commands to make sure that at least attend. And there John will be able to measure the men up, whether they're worth keeping their ingenuity, or whether they'll be best suited as puppets to play at his strings. With a good piece of work done, he downs the rest of his vitae, rather pleased with himself and his contacts. He sets aside a small message to his accountant to make sure that his web is fully compensated for their great work. He has other avenues of influence in which he needs to explore, but at this time, the hour is growing late and he does not want to tax his contacts too much. He'll concentrate simply on reaffirming his hold on the police. And then the arduous task of his other interests. John leans back and smiles. For one time in his life, he's truly satisfied. He's prince of the city, powerful. As a child, in which he has a small amount of affection for, as well as his paramour has returned to him. His clan is no longer in his hands and seems to be doing well. The kindred of the city may not like him, but they certainly respect him. And from what he hears, everyone is, well, eager to head out into the city and work their influence and start becoming Camarilla kindred. Soon the city will belong to them, and in that belong to him. Such control over the city hasn't been seen in Wolf's days, and professional rivalries and competition always brought out the best in John. He thinks briefly to the Anarchs, the Giovannis. Well, distractions really, nothing else. The Anarchs are at least behaving, as far as John knows, but who knows what's happening behind closed doors in their pit that is known the Projects. This treaty is an interesting experiment, and one he looks forward to, at least entertaining. But it all depends on the Primogen Council, of course, which will be meeting soon, in a couple of days. If it's against popular opinion of the Elders, he will scrap it without a second thought. He cannot afford to alienate the Primogen Council, not at this early stage. The Giovanni, however, well, he has shaken hands with the one who truly controls, and he understands the benefit of cooperation and business. It does not mean that his family, insulting and, well, base as they are, should get a free ride. No, no. We will see how they enjoy being left out into the cold, the Camarilla kindred all despising and hating them, while the true controllers of the city will carry on business as normal. It's good to be prince. End scene.